that Nitzchius is Nishash and Yaakov and didn't start with the other others. So I want to try to understand a phenomenon that we take very lightly, and we don't quite get the full depth of what the Torah is giving us. The concept of bailus, the concept of ownership, is understood in a shallow way as being something that you need it for an appropriate structuring of an economic society. You need to have ownership, you need to have mine, yours, transitions, purchase, transfer property. It's a necessity. It's a consensus of how to organize economic life. But let's look at a certain phenomena of bailus. If a person wanted money, and someone comes and tells him, you know what, in the rough side of town, I'm not sure whether Chicago is the east, the south, whatever, but in one part of those town, there's somebody standing there with a fat wallet, probably has $1,000 in his pocket, go and take it. A bardas would answer, toit me sugar. What do you think I'm gonna risk my life for $1,000? It's crazy. Okay, now let's go the other way. I have $1,000 in my pocket, my $1,000, and I'm walking in a rough part of town, and somebody tries to grab it. Many a person, including bardas, will struggle. It's a halacha. It says that above a machteris is chayiv, because the Torah was made that a person will not, even at a risk of life, will not let someone else take it. What's the pshat? Same $1,000, same life. The answer is, bailus is more than just a legal statement that I own these $1,000. It's part of a person's atzmius. It becomes part of a person's own mitzius, that money, that kinyan. Another place where the Torah is made, if two people are fighting over an object, one is a big, strong, tough, rough guy, one is an elderly, frail Talmud Chacham. One of the ways that Bezin decides it is called Olam Gava. Let the stronger men win. And Rishonim, Rosh, those with his Mahalchim, say because the person who owns it will struggle harder to get it. The Torah says the Torah was maimed that bailus is not simply a convention, a necessary social convention. It's a shirish in a person's nefesh, that things that are his become at some point him. And just like a person will fight to keep a finger at all costs, he will fight to keep his kinyanim also. Where is the shirish of kinyanim? What type of action creates a kinyan? So I once heard from one of my rebbeim, very profound thought. He brought a Reb Chaim. Reb Chaim is Reb Chaim Shtol Su Yerushalmi. If a person goes and he plants things in a field that's hefker. If he plants seeds in a field that's somebody else's, the halacha is it belongs to the person who owns the field, and the person who planted it gets something, depending on what type of field it is, etc. What about if I plant in a field that's hefker? Who does it belong to? So Reb Chaim brings Yerushalmi, and Yerushalmi says that it belongs to the person that planted it. The understanding in it is, human effort, amal, of a person is the root of ownership. Where somebody else owns the field beforehand, so his amal had given him the field, and as a conflict between my amal and his amal, we need to pass them one way or the other. But if it's hefker, the very fact that I had invested my effort my sweat, my time into something makes it mine by extension of self. Koicha shel Adam is like an Adam, and it's a hemshach of a person. And therefore, the shirish of kinyanim lies in amelis. There's a Tosa says in Bar Mitzia that even if you hold habotes kain in hefka, that by looking at something alone in hefka you kaina, but you need a maisa koldable, a maisa kala. You need some maisa. There is no kinyan, no acquisition without a maisa. And therefore, the shirish of kinyanim and the shirish of acquisition and by extension incorporation to self lies in Amelus Dafka. I think that that was the inyan of Yaakov Avinu's beginning to take, to bring the stamp of Nitzchias on the kinyanim of Klal Yisrael. Avram Avinu, HaKadosh Baruch Hu was mevarech in with his money. HaKadosh Baruch Hu brought him a shidduch. There's no mention in the Torah how it came about. That's all we see in the Torah. Yitzchak had a shtar from his father, and he had a shidduch through his father, and that's what he got. Yaakov Avinu lost everything, and everything that he had was earned by his own sweat. B'chol koichi avadati asavichem, and therefore the money and the shidduchim and the children all became inseparable from Yaakov, because that which is acquired through Amul is yours and inseparable from yourself. That world of Amelus, the Rosh Hashivas, Zechayin Levracha, Rav Nosson Tzvi's Mida was Amelus. He never took anything for granted. When he came to yeshiva, he was a person with kishonos, but not extraordinary kishonos that one would make it a quote unquote a breeze. He worked, he was omel for everything. His background didn't give him that world automatically. He wasn't born into it be'etzim. There was a be'koyach in the Shloshim, but not be'etzim. It was through working. And the scene that I remember, I came in Tavshin Lamed, he was a younger man, a chashvinger man. But the one thing that is rememberable is the relentless, constant learning. And it's not only, the Chaznish says, Amelus in Torah is specifically on things that the Seichel is not nene from. When a person learns over and over and over and over again, as he would, he sat with chavrusas, every 2 hours was another chavrusa, another chabura, another, either somebody was learning from, somebody was teaching to, or somebody was learning with. It was a constant rotation. I don't know how many times a day you must learn over and chewed over the same inyanim. That, everything that he was kind in Torah, he was kind of with sweat and with amul. It's not because he was infatuated with Torah that he worked so hard. It's because he worked so hard that he was so infatuated with it. He was a worker, and things that you honestly work for become you and become yours, and they become an inseparable part of yourself. It's one of the great shortcomings, I would say, of people today. We'd like to get things easy, but things that you get easy, you don't get. You can have them floating around your nechassim, but they don't become part of you. Bachrim who have a hard time learning, And they need to put in effort, become discouraged, because I need to learn over and over and over again. So what's the point of it? Revolba writes in his Adrach and Ali Shur, when he's addressing a bacha who might have kina for others who learn much more quickly and are brilliant and can catch very quickly in Yanim, he writes, yes, your friend is quick and sharp, and those are very important in Yanim to Chab Teira. But he doesn't have what you have. You, after you've worked hard to finally get to what you know, the feeling of attachment that you have to that learning, he doesn't have. I wonder how many people understand what he means over there. Unless you saw someone like that, unless you saw Rav Nosson Tzvi's kesher to his nafshi, to his learning, you wouldn't understand what he said. And bachim who are quick, and chab quickly, and don't shirk from being amul because they quote-unquote don't need to, don't understand that what they're learning is not going to stay with them. They can remember it maybe, they can repeat it, they can hack with it, but if something is to be yours, it's only what you worked on. And for someone who's a bigger balkishrin, he needs to learn more, deeper, bigger hekif, whatever it is. But that which came without effort will not be yours. That's how the Torah and HaKadosh Baruch Hu shtal ravek. And Reb Nosson was the model of it. The simcha that he had from learning was the result of the profound effort that he put in for so many years. It's true about Torah. It's true about everything else. What does it look like? Yeah, we pick up a little of an esrog and it's fine. But when you have to pull yourself across the room, when to get up for davening, it's not just sleepily rolling out of bed and sort of coming into the Beis Medrash. It's a major effort. So when a person has to work a half hour to pull himself out of bed, walk across the room, cross over to the yeshiva, and daven. So when a person says, Baruch Sha'ama Ve'oyo Ilam, that becomes part of himself. Those are words that don't roll off the lips. It's nefesh he put into it. He would speak about Shmuzin, Benam Chaveroi, was something very regal. He would sometimes call Reb Chaim. Often he would say, Reb Chaim, our Rebbe in Musa, the Shiva, the Mir. But a lot of times he would say something simple. One thing that was quoted a lot is where he got up at a kenis for Lashon Hara, I think it was a Shalom, and he said to speak about somebody else, V'yahavtalar echa kamoicha. And that was it. How meaningful and inspiring is a speech about V'yahavtalar echa kamoicha? If you want to be sure of getting nobody to come to a drasha, say that you can speak of V'yahavtalar echa kamoicha. I assure you. Our ears are geared that as soon as we hear that word, it turns off automatically, within a flash second. It has no inspiration to anyone. Those words have been said and oversaid, and you never feel the person means it. So why did it shake you when he said it? And the answer is, because for us it's words. Words that we picked up without thinking too much. And, you know, we pass it on. When we have nothing else to talk about,